Start straight away. They're already running right by 5 to 7 minutes. So this is scope of my presentation. This is a small introduction, and we'll discuss a bit about ECG and the situs, and how to use the waveforms in these. How to use the waveforms in the ECG, and a brief mention on clinical classification of congenital heart disease. And bulk of the discussion will be focused on case scenarios. I approximately attributed the font size to the time I am going to dedicate for each of these subheadings. There are some scattered quick tips for quick references, and I omitted this quiz for this session. Though I have some material on X-ray, I don't think I'll be discussing them much because of lack of time. So, ECG in congenital heart disease, what should one expect? ECG is a very insensitive tool for the diagnosis of congenital heart disease, except arrhythmias. A hemodynamically significant structural heart disease may exist with insignificant or absent ECG changes, and yet analyzing the ECG in congenital heart disease can provide valuable insight in understanding the hemodynamics as well as nature of the underlying disease. And in neonates, you should interpret it with extreme caution, because right ventricular hypertrophy is the rule in newborns, and RV dominance may extend up to 2 years or even more. And first and foremost, once you get an ECG in a congenital heart disease, is to confirm the situs, because only situs alters permits us useful interpretation of coexisting abnormalities. The sinus P wave axis correlates to the visceroatrial situs. So if you have a normal situs, you expect a P wave that is in left lower quadrant, that is positive in 2 and usually in 1 as well, but always in 2, and negative in AVR. Both these should be met to call it as a situs alters. And in situs inverses, the reverse is true. P will be positive in AVR and negative in lead 2 as well as 1. Once you have a situs alters, then only you need to proceed to the subsequent steps. After visceroatrial situs, confirm that cardiac mass is in the left side of the thorax, that is levocardia. The precordial RV progression correlates well with the position of cardiac mass in the thorax. In levocardia, there is a usual RV progression from small r and big S in V1 to a small q and big R with or without a S wave in V6. And transition usually happens in the mid-precordial age, V3 or V4. While in dextrocardia, the RV regresses from V1, which shows a large R and a small S. And by the time it reaches V6, you'll get almost totally negative QS complex. If you switch the ECG lead positions to the right of the chest, we'll get the anticipated usual R wave progression akin to the normal. Another clue here is about mesocardia, in which the mid-precordial leads, usually V3 or V4, shows the largest R wave or S wave voltages. And either if you go left or to the right, V1, V2 or V5, V6, the QRS complex are much smaller. If you see this pattern, you should think of mesocardia. After confirming situs alters and levocardia, check whether the ventricular relay situs alters loop heart or a D loop heart, or vice versa. Peptidic Q wave seen in the lateral leads, that is V5, V6, and 1 and AVL, correlates with the normal ventricular location with LV being left to the of RV. Whereas absence of septal Q waves may be a subtle sign of ventricular inversion. This is an ECG example of situs alters with dextrocardia. You can see that the P waves are positive in lead 2 and negative in AVR. Whereas QRS complex, you see a small R wave and a large S wave in V1. And as you go to the V6, R wave has regressed. If you take right side leads like V3R and V4R below the here in the panel, you see R waves are getting larger. That suggests a situs alters. Visceroatrial situs alters, but cardiac mass to the right of a right in the thorax, that is dextrocardia. You expect usually complex congenital heart disease here. But nevertheless, you need not interpret this ECG anymore. It's not going to be of much use. This arrow is showing the P wave axis as well as R wave regression. And this is the X-ray of the same patient, which confirms situs alters and sorry, this X-ray of a different patient that shows situs inverses and dextrocardia. And yet another X-ray where you may see a dextro position, where ECG will not reflect much changes. Coming to heterotaxy, this is another catch where ECG may not be very much useful. There can be right atrial isomerism, where both atria are morphological right atria, and they can have two SJ nodes with two different PVA morphologies. More useful is left atrial isomerism, where there is no SJ node, you have abnormal PVA access. So again, your evaluation of situs and subsequent things becomes difficult. It's the case of situs ambiguous with left isomerism. You can see that PVA access is not normal. To see such ECGs, better not to attempt further interpretation and just skip to other modes of evaluation. Having confirmed situs altus, now we can see for clues for congenital heart disease in each of the waveforms of the ECG. We'll start with P and PR interval. P wave reflects right or left or by atrial enlargement. Many conditions can cause this. So we have to interpret this in the face of clinical evaluation, symptoms, and other signs. Prolonged PR intervals or AV blocks can occur independently or can be part. Some congenital heart diseases are known to cause them, like corrected transpositions, double outlet right ventricle, single ventricle, AV canal defects, Epstein's anomaly. All except Epstein's anomaly, these are due to condition system abnormality, where either there is a poor development of the AV septal region or there is a ventricular inversion. Less commonly, short PR interval, as in seen in pre-excitation, can be a clue to the underlying structural heart disease, like which may happen in Epstein's anomaly, corrected TGA, or tricuspid atresia. And QRS complexes give immense amount of information apart from the situs and leukocardia. First and foremost, I usually see the loop, frontal QRS loop. It's a vector cardiographic concept that is translated to the scalar ECG. But to be simple, counterclockwise loop represents Q wave in one end AVL, and clockwise loop means initial Q is there in inferior leads, just like left anterior or left posterior ME block respectively. And when you analyze ventricular forces, focus on the pericardial leads to see whether it's a dominant RV, dominant LV, or both are dominant, as in Katz-Waschel phenomenon, biventricular dominance. Rarely you can get same type of morphology in every pericardial lead. It's called stereotypical QRS complex, which is seen in single ventricle. Cause for this is lack of the interventricular septum, so there's no transition to happen, and all the leads appear the same. So frontal QRS loop and dominant ventricle should be analyzed in every case, especially congenital cyanotic heart disease. Now there is a list of diseases known to cause counterclockwise loop. Commonly left axis deviation, but can happen with right axis deviation also. Inlet VST, endocardial cushion defect, cyanotics like tricuspid atresia, double outlet right ventricle, and single ventricle. This DORV and single ventricle can have an immense variety of presentations. So there's no single place you can classify them under. Now clues from QRS. This is like with RV enlargement. If they cause volume overload of the right ventricle, they tend to cause right bundle branch block and right axis deviation. Whereas if it's a pressure overload of the right ventricle, you tend to get a monophasic R or a notched RR dash with deep T inversions in the right pericardial leads. Indeed, you have to check for the RS ratio appropriate for the age. And in left ventricle enlargement, pressure overload manifests as LVH with strain, which may be the only finding you may see in aortic stenosis or pressure overload conditions of left ventricle. Or volume overload manifests as a deep Q wave in the lateral leads, V5 and V6, along with LVH. Sometimes T wave may offer subtle clues, like in corrected transposition, you may have an upright T wave in all pericardial leads due to the side-by-side ventricular relation. And in DTGA, you may have a right upright tall T in V1, which is taller than that in the left-sided leads. And finally, interpretation should always happen in the context of physiology. You have to classify at the end of your clinical examination, with or without the help of X-ray, you have to classify it into left to right shunt, right to left shunt, among that cyanotic with reduced pulmonary blood flow, cyanotic with increased pulmonary blood flow, or the Eisenmenger physiology. In obstructive lesions, left-sided as well as right-sided, pulmonary venous hypertension or heart failure, and some of them are not classifiable typically under any of these, like Epstein's anomaly or corrected transposition. In today's discussion, we'll focus more on left side, left to right shunt, and cyanosis with reduced pulmonary blood flow, because these are the more common things, and most of the increased blood flow pulmonary blood flow situations manifest at a very young age and tend to develop Eisenmenger if untreated by the time they become they grow into childhood. Regarding obstructive lesions and all other lesions apart from these two mentioned, ECG have a limited role. Obstructive lesions typically manifest as pressure overload of the ipsilateral chamber. We are not going to discuss much on them today. Similarly, heart failure and pulmonary venous hypertension, apart from left atrial enlargement, you may not have much clues. So as to cyanotic heart disease with increased pulmonary blood flow, most of them will present as a RBB or RVH-RAD, and differentiating them solely based on ECG is a futile attempt. So we'll discuss more on what actually ECG can be useful of. When you have cyanotic heart disease, you have to classify them to reduce pulmonary blood flow, most characteristically manifesting as PELS, and within them, RV dominance or LV dominance. For this, ECG is very useful, apart from apical impulse, of course. RV dominance is classically seen in tetralogy of Fallot and TOF physiologies. There are 7 or 8 of them, and rare conditions like critical PS with an ASD. And LV dominance is classically seen tricuspid atresia, VST PS, and pulmonary atresia with intact ventricular septum with a small RV. Essentially, RV size is normal, RV is underfilled. So this tricuspid atresia, some people tend to classify under TOF physiology, whereas others classify under admixture physiology. I'm not stressing much on admixture physiology today, because for analyzing an ECG, it doesn't matter whether the physiology is admixture or not. We are more interested in which chamber is dominant. An increased pulmonary blood flow situation, you are unlikely to get them in your examination apart from when they develop Eisenmenger. And they can be RV dominance like TGA, single ventricle, common atrium, or TA-PVC. All of them will cause RV dominance and right axis deviation. It's very difficult to differentiate just based on ECG. And others will have LV dominance, again tricuspid atresia with unrestricted pulmonary blood flow, and variants of single ventricle, or biventricular dominance, again truncus arteriosus, single ventricle. So these are the situations where ECG is not going to be of much use. And finally, the Eisenmenger physiology, again it will be all the same, RV dominance. So no point in discussing or analyzing much in those scenarios. Now we'll go to the chunk of the presentation. This case one, this is classifiable into miscellaneous. It's a 10-month baby boy, asymptomatic, but for a lower sternal border murmur. There's no cyanosis. There's no meaning in mentioning NIHA class, but it's asymptomatic. That's what I meant here. The X-ray shows mild cardiomegaly with normal pulmonary blood flow. Here we have physiology where pulmonary blood flow is normal. There's no cyanosis, and there is a murmur. So conditions to be considered here are small, balanced left to right shunts, mild or moderate valvular lesions like pulmonary stenosis, aortic stenosis, bicuspid aortic valve. And when you see the ECG, something should strike you. This is actually showing very prominent pointed P wave, suggestive of a right atrial enlargement. And when you have a right atrial enlargement in a patient with left lower sternal border murmur, always think of tricuspid regurgitation and Epstein's anomaly. It can present with cyanosis, without cyanosis, with gross cardiomegaly, with no cardiomegaly. All the varieties are possible. But the important clue is that P wave is characteristically pointed, and it can be very large and called as Himalayan P waves. And there are a series of ECGs on same conditions in different patients, different ages, different presentations. So we'll discuss the ECG findings of Epstein's anomaly based on them. So we have a splintered QRS, as I have marked here, and this finding correlates with the size of atrialized right ventricle. So the pointed P, large right atrial enlargement, correlates with severity of tricuspid regurgitation. A long PR interval is usually due to atrial enlargement rather than AV conduction problem. So it again reflects the contribution by the P wave, whereas splintered QRS is contributed mainly by the size of the atrialized RV. Left ventricle is essentially normal unless you have any coexisting disease. And this is another ECG, again showing a very pointed P wave, which can even be negative, but sharp negative. This is again right atrial enlargement, not a left atrial enlargement. Left atrial enlargement will be shallow negative, as whereas this will be steep negative. And most of them will have a positive complex in V1, RBB type, and splintering of QRS. And as the disease advances, we have an extremely dilated right atrium. You tend to get Q waves in the V1 because V1 now becomes cavity facing. And if it's extremely large, these Q waves can extend up to V2, V3, or even V4. And again, splintering of QRS, long PR interval. And in the most severe forms, you may get AVR as well as V1 look alike because both of them are now facing the cavity. So this is an 11-year-old boy who actually had a refractory arrhythmia syncope, took for EPS RFA, had a very long PR interval, severely distorted QRS with marked splintering, and V1 and AVR are looking alike, all close to severe Epstein's anomaly. And if you don't find a right bundle branch block pattern, especially when your PR interval is short, in a case of Epstein's anomaly, think of an aneurysm, most of them being right side. This is a summary of findings of Epstein's anomaly. Right atrial enlargement, it can be very large and called as Himalayan P waves. PR prolonged generally, but can be short if pre-excited. And right bundle branch block with normal or rightward axis. Splintered QRS representing the atrialized right atrium. And initial Q in V1 or even beyond. And in severe cases, V1 and AVR may look alike. This is a radiograph. I'm skipping the radiograph part today. These are the same patient's radiographs actually. And this is a second example. This is cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood flow situation. It's a 20-month baby, presents with congenital heart failure. And this is an important history. History of congenital heart failure suggests that pulmonary blood flow is increased. Or there is pulmonary venous hypertension, LV dysfunction. But for that, among congenital heart disease, cyanosis with heart failure represents cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood flow. There is a systolic murmur and mild cyanosis, and X-ray shows cardiomegaly and increased pulmonary blood flow. X-ray is another clue whether cardiomegaly is generally suggestive of increased pulmonary blood flow situation along with plethora. So this is the ECG. What we can see in the frontal leads is situs is solitus. P wave is not very much remarkable. It's just normal appearing P wave. So is PR interval. Whereas the counterclockwise loop is very much evident, seen as Q waves in 1 as well as AVL. So when you have a cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood flow, you have to look which chamber is dominant, RV or LV. And here obviously V6 is showing large R waves. V1 is showing deep S waves. And there is no clue of any RV. V1 is showing very small or smallish R waves, and there is no much S wave in the lateral lead, suggestive of a very poor RV representation. So, I have a cyanotic heart disease with increased pulmonary blood flow, counterclockwise loop with left axis deviation and LV dominance. Most important differential diagnosis: tricuspid atresia. There's a lack of RV forces, and it is Q waves. And generally, Q waves also reflect pulmonary blood flow in shunt lesions. If you have immense or good pulmonary blood flow, you will get well-developed Q waves in V6. Whereas if you have poor pulmonary blood flow, your LV forces will be inconspicuous, and Q waves will be minimal or even absent. This guy indeed had a tricuspid atresia with non-restrictive VST and subsequently underwent PA banding. You can see the PA band as well as the external bias there. And X-ray shows plethora. The third case is again a 7-month kid with cyanosis and increased pulmonary blood flow, manifested as heart failure, and X-ray showed plethora. Again, you look for LV dominance versus RV dominance in this scenario, and counterclockwise loop, and here's a precordial lead for you. There is indeed some representation of RV forces, unlike in the previous case. You can see some R waves in V1, not very small ones. Whereas V6 is showing well-developed LV forces. This is X-ray, same guy, in some plethora. And he had tricuspid atresia with DTG and a non-restrict VST. Though ECG cannot tell you whether vessels are transposed or not, well-developed RV forces and good Q waves in the lateral leads generally happens in tricuspid atresia with transposition, because here the VST is commonly non-restrictive. It's another case, again cyanosis with reduced pulmonary blood flow, but again with LV dominance. This is an example. It's not a very common clinical scenario. It's a 2-month baby, cyanotic and deeply cyanotic, and soft systolic murmur in the precordium. X-rays mark remarkable only for reduced pulmonary blood flow. And this is a very important ECG here. Again, you are seeing counterclockwise with left axis deviation. You have a counterclockwise with left axis in a cyanosis. First diagnosis, second and third diagnosis, everything is tricuspidary atresia. But here we go. Though this is a tricuspidary atresia, I don't have an LV force here. LV forces are not very much remarkable, and RV forces are also negligible. V3R and V4R are shown. No much RV forces. This was in fact a case of hypoplastic right heart. LV as well as pulmonary valve as well as tricuspid valve was hypoplastic. But this is an important point here, that counterclockwise QRS axis. Though it's a pulmonary atresia along with tricuspid atresia, unlike pulmonary atresia, your frontal loop is counterclockwise and not clockwise. That's important of frontal QRS loop, especially in cyanotic heart disease. It's a very subtle clue, but very useful one as well. So these are the quick tips. Tricuspid atresia broadly can be classified into with transposition or without transposition. With transposition, you tend to have a right atrial enlargement, and LVH and left axis deviation are marked. Left axis deviation is marked because RV is more ill developed. Whereas if you have a transposed great vessels, you expect a non-restive VST, better pulmonary blood flow, so you may have LA forces, RV is better developed, so it tends to pull the QRS towards normal, leftward to normal. And have a clue from the ECG regarding a transposition, though it's not a diagnostic. I'm skipping the X-ray again. This table summarized cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood flow. Common differential diagnosis are DTGA, TAPVC, DORV, truncus, tricuspid atresia, and single ventricle. So the red ones show some helpful ECG features, especially counterclockwise loop and LVH, whereas others show a RVH type of pattern in the ECG. Single ventricle can be a great vasoconstrictor. It can have LV forces, RV forces, or even stereotypical QRS. Coming to left to right shunts, this is an example of 50-year-old lady with exertional palpitations and dyspnea. She had a continuous murmur, prominent diastolic component in the pulmonary area, and normal saturation. So left to right shunts generally are amenable for clinical diagnosis based on murmurs, and continuous murmurs suggest a patent ductus arteriosus. And again, the ECG is to be analyzed in that background. We have isolated LV enlargement, that to diastolic type of LV overload. You can see septal Q waves, prominent and upright T waves, without an ST depression, suggesting LV diastolic overload. So this can be any cause of LV diastolic overload. So you have to interpret in the basis of clinical history and findings, then you can diagnose a patent ductus arteriosus. That was her X-ray, and she was taken for device closure. She was operable despite her advanced age. This is a 16-month boy, recurrent lower respiratory infection and mid-sternal murmur, upper sternal border. Again, no cyanosis, recurrent LRTA suggests an increased pulmonary blood flow situation. So we are going to deal possibly with the left to right shunt. And this is ECG. Again, in pre-tricuspid shunts, you tend to get a RV dominance, whereas in post-tricuspid shunt, you get a LV or a biventricular dominance. In this ECG, you have a sinus rhythm, situs is altus. If you see V1, you get a RVVV here, suggests of a RV and deep S waves in V6, both suggesting RV, significant RV forces. That of RVVV suggesting a diastolic type, and along with the history, diagnosis of AST can be easily made. Other signs of AST here are the crochet sign, where there's a notching in the inferior leads of QRS. That's the X-ray, the same patient. He had an AST which was later device closed. So 58-year-old man, frequent LRT in childhood, and subsequently exertional palpitations and fatigue. Last two symptoms now, mid-systolic murmur at base of the heart. No desaturation. Again, the history suggests of a left to right shunt, but exertional palpitation suggests a chamber enlargement possibly, and fatigue may suggest a low cardiac output. This is ECG. Again, which of the chambers is dominant? Here we can see clear RV forces, that two of right bundle bench block type. And if you see carefully, There is some clue that there is a Q wave in AVL suggesting again a counterclockwise flow. And when you have this counterclockwise flow in a left to right shunt, always think of ostium primum ASD, inlet VST, or AV canal defect. Similar things, because in usually ASDs, you tend to get a clockwise flow rather than a counterclockwise flow. So you have a precordial pattern consistent with the AST, but frontal QRS is leftward and loop is counterclockwise. Now your diagnosis, based on clinical findings, of course, should be an ostium primum AST. Other differential being, ECG differentials being AV canal defects. But AV canal defects generally tend to have good LV forces as well. Let's see the 6-year-old child. Again, left to right shunt physiology, heart failure, recurrent LRTI, and pan-systolic murmur. When you have a pan-systolic murmur in the left to right shunt, your diagnosis, first diagnosis will be VST, and along with that, you will also consider AV canal defects. Again, ECG can be very much useful to differentiate between these two. And here, rightus solidus again, evocardia, but both RV as well as LV forces are prominent. You can see tall R waves here in V1, and you can see the craniovascular sign, tall R, midprecordial lead showing R as well as S, large R and large S. This should add up to 50 or 60. And more importantly, you know that there is a VST, but it's counterclockwise loop with left axis deviation. And this Q waves also suggests that pulmonary blood flow is reasonably good. I'll answer the questions towards the end, as time permits. I just noted there are some questions. I'll try to address them at the end of this presentation. In this case, we know that there is a VST, but this counterclockwise loop with left axis deviation should prompt you to think of AV canal defects and or inlet VST. This child indeed had a Down syndrome, AV canal defect, also with cleft AML and hyperkinetic PH. Probably operable because there were significant Q waves seen in lateral leads and LV forces were very much prominent. So this is a differential diagnosis of left to right shunt physiology. Retricuspid shunts like AST manifest RV volume overload and presents late. This is a clinical differential. And VST or endocardial cushion defects manifests LV volume overload. ECG shows counterclockwise loop and presents much earlier. As PDA or AP window shows LV volume overload and presents early with a continuous murmur. Another condition you can get easily mistaken here is DORV with increased pulmonary blood flow. Because of the increased pulmonary blood flow, you may not get a cyanosis, but if you check saturation, it may be less. So RV dominance in the ECG as well as the counterclockwise loop suggests a DORV. You expect an LV dominance, you thought it's a clinical VST, but the ECG is showing RV dominance. Now think of a DORV with unrestricted pulmonary blood flow. That's how ECG is to be used in the light of clinical examination. Here is the quick tips for ECG in left to right shunts. Ostium secundum AST, RBP right axis. Cross head strain may happen. If PR is prolonged, think of familial AST. Ostium primum AST, again RBP, but counterclockwise loop and left axis deviation. And if there is significant MR or large VST, LV forces are also dominant. Sinus venous AST, abnormal PV axis because sinus node may be underdeveloped. But take it from me, you will almost always never see this. I've never seen one, it's so unusual. But RBP and right axis deviation will be there. And AV canal defect, counterclockwise with left axis, biventricular forces if VST is large, and LV volume overload if MR or large VST is there. And VST, biventricular forces again, RBP may be there, and the Katz-Waschel's phenomenon is also possibly present if the VST is large. PDA is pure LV volume overload. So you are unlikely to mistake in a PDA because of the continuous murmur towards ASD. But in VST, ECG may give you further clues regarding it's an AV canal defect or an inlet VST. You can put another word here. If you have ostium secundum AST type of clinical findings, same ECG, RBP right axis deviation, but the patient has cyanosis, now you consider TAPVC, total anomalous pulmonary venous connection. It doesn't have a specific ECG for itself, but in a suspected AST patient, you have cyanosis and RV the right excitation suggests CT ABUC. Similarly, if you have a ECG consistent with ostium primum AST, but you still have cyanosis, you think it's a good permanent blood flow, RVV, counterclockwise, LED, everything fits in well with ostium primum AST, but there is cyanosis. Now think of common atrium. You will not find any specific ECG finding for common atrium, but this constellation of findings should prompt you to think of common atrium. So the left to right hand x-rays, AST, VST, and PD, we'll skip them for today. Then ECG in Eisenmenger physiology is usually very boring, right? RV pressure overload and right axis deviation, but sometimes it can still give you some clues. This is an example of 19-month heart failure in infancy, but now improved. There's very ominous history. We have a heart failure which has now improved. It should either be an setting in of Eisenmenger, or if you are fortunate, it may be a VST with RV outflow obstruction being developing later and improvement happening. But if it is an Eisenmenger, it's really ominous, and there's a systolic murmur and PH findings. X-ray shows cardiomegaly, borderline plethora, prominent PS. Everything goes hand in hand with Eisenmenger. So you look for the ECG. You can see RV dominance. V1 shows huge R waves and no S waves. This is a clue for RV dominance. But if you go to the frontal leads, you still can see Q waves in one AVL, especially in AVL, though the axis is rightward. So this counterclockwise loop with right axis deviation in an Eisenmenger suggests AV canal defect, or ostium primum AST, or a common atrium. Usually it's AV canal defect, or even a large inlet VST. Otherwise, all Eisenmenger ECs are boring. They will just show RV forces, the right axis deviation. And so you focus on loop. Loop is an important clinical finding, sorry, ECG finding in congenital heart disease. The same patient's precordial leads, again showing inconspicuous LV forces and huge RV forces, deep S waves in V6. The same patient's X-ray, showing a fantastic main pulmonary artery segment and peripheral pruning with oligemia. Again, the diagnosis was Down syndrome, complete AV canal defect, and it was inoperable by CAT study. What about Eisenmenger physiology? Left to right shunts as well as right to left shunts can go to Eisenmenger physiology. Its initial heart failure improves subsequently, then cyanosis set in, then that is left to right shunt going for Eisenmenger. It usually happens later in the life. Whereas right to left shunt going to Eisenmenger presents very early, maybe first year of life or within 2 to 3 years. They present much earlier with cyanosis, most classical being TGA. You have deep cyanosis since birth, and by end of 1 year, you either die or go for Eisenmenger. They have cyanosis with heart failure, and cyanosis deepens as Eisenmenger sets. We'll skip this x-ray again. It's a 21-day baby with heart failure, no murmur. X-ray shows pulmonary venous hypertension and cardiomegaly. So in contrast to shunts, now this is a 21-day baby with heart failure. There are no much congenital heart disease that present this way. And when they present, they can be really classical. This shows a ST elevation in lateral leads along with Q waves. I will show you the precordial leads. There you go, precordial leads also shows ST changes, and V6 LV forces are not much. This was a case of L-kappa, you must be already guessing it. It's very classical, this X-ray. Point here is L-kappa can present a severe LV dysfunction, and LV dysfunction may improve after the surgery. So in any heart failure in childhood as well as infancy, always consider L-kappa as a differential diagnosis. This is another case, 7-year-old girl, heart failure, muffled heart sounds, X-ray shows PVH, severe LV dysfunction, again in L-kappa, where sign is very subtle, there's no ST elevation now, it's all evolved, but now there's a deep Q wave in AVL. LV forces are not much, though the classic L-kappa description is LVH, left axis deviation, as well as Q waves and ST changes. LVH may not be always seen, and most often they improve after the surgery. Despite the fact that they have LV dysfunction, once you do the surgery, LV function improves, and the R wave can regenerate. These are quick tips for L-kappa, narrow but deep Q waves, LVH, left axis deviation, the classical triad but not seen in all. Now the most important for exam going PGs again is a phylophysiology. cyanosis with reduced pulmonary blood flow. It's a 5-year, 6-month child. Saturation of 90%. There's no clinically evident cyanosis, but desaturation is there, 90%. And there is congestive heart failure in infancy, the history of infective endocarditis. What you can hear on auscultation is a soft P2 and ejection systolic murmur. Now, this is a very important finding in this physiology, because this single finding, presence of a pulmonary ejection systolic murmur, tells you that pulmonary wall is not atretic. Among the differential diagnoses for a fellow physiology, should consider first 3, 4, or 5, or even first 10 will be tetralogy of Fallot. But you should also consider double outer right ventricle with VST PS, DTGA or LTGA, again with VST and PS, pulmonary atresia with VST and PS, pulmonary atresia with intact IVS, AV canal defect with PS, or TOF with absent pulmonary wall. So here, if you have an ejection systolic murmur, you can safely exclude pulmonary atresia with VST or without VST. Both of them will have a continuous murmur, and TOF with absent pulmonary wall will declare itself with a typical to and fro murmur. So what we are left with is TOF, DORV, DTGA, LTGA, LTGA, and AV canal defect. In this context, some clinical findings, X-ray findings, as well as ECG findings may help you to pinpoint or prefer one diagnosis over the other. And that's important of ECG, and that's how we are going to discuss it as well. We're not going to see ECG changes of each of these diagnoses. Once you have a TOF physiology, you have excluded the atretic lesions by absence of continuous murmur, but by the presence of an antegrade pulmonary area systolic murmur. Now we look at the ECG. Hallmark of TOF lesion is absence of S wave in V1 with abrupt appearance of S wave in V2. This very marked early transition. No S wave in V1, but sudden appearance of S wave in V2. This is very classical of tetralogy of Fallot. You are happy, it's a tetralogy of Fallot, but on a closer look, you can see that frontal QRS is showing, this is a rapid transition. Frontal QRS is showing a counterclockwise loop. Now that should ring a bell, because that's very unusual in TOF. You almost always will never have such a finding in isolated or typical TOF. Not only that, you are having deep Q waves in V6 and marked LVH, which is also not, TOF is a LV dominant condition. So if you have a LV as well as RV dominance, TOF is RV dominant condition, if you have marked LVH, you should think something else is happening, we are missing something. And this classical reason for this counterclockwise rotation with LV forces is this DORV, apart from tricuspidatresia, of course, but tricuspidatresia will not have this much RV forces. Whereas DORV can have all sorts of combinations. So in a TOF patient, if you have a PR prolongation in the ECG, counterclockwise loop, or abnormally prominent LV forces, think of DORV, because clinically, almost always, you will never diagnose a DORV separate from TOF. This guy had a TORV, VST, and mild PS, because PS was mild, pulmonary blood flow was very good, and LV forces were prominent. Again, quick tips, PR prolongation with counterclockwise loop point towards DORV rather than TOF. Counterclockwise loop with left axis deviation and LV forces suggests DORV without PS. And as PS increases, RV becomes hypertrophic and QRS significantly shift towards right. But still, loop remains counterclockwise. So even with DORVs with severe PS, where you get RV dominance, your loop can still be counterclockwise. And that will be your clue that it's not a pure TOF. There is something similar to TOF. Another case of phylophysiology, a 7-month baby with cyanosis and possibly spells. We are happy because you know 6 or 7 diagnoses will fit into this. And look at the ECG, there's a prominent RV in V1 and sudden appearance of S in V2. Yeah, that's classical sign of phylophysiology. And compared to other case, you see that clockwise loop rather than counterclockwise. There's no QA in AVL and LV forces are just there. Not extremely prominent. More than that, deep S wave in V6 suggests an RV dominance. This was a typical TOF, and this is how typical TOF should look like. When you think atypical, you think of other causes. It's a rapid V2 transition, this X-ray of the same patient. Nothing much to add that it's a typical TOF. And now another case of TOF physiology, 3-year boy with cyanosis and continuous murmur. Now that's very important, the continuous murmur with a saturation of 80. Rest of all is unimportant. You have a cyanosis with continuous murmur, almost always you are likely to deal with a pulmonary atresia with or without VST. Again, ECG can help you there. This X-ray of the same patient. Poor quality ECG, sorry for that. But again, situs solitus. Loop is for stop fault, we extrude counterclockwise loop. Yeah, it's clockwise loop. So it should be chondroitrichia with or without VST. Now CV1, RV forces. V2, again, rapid transition. SWV has come. So we're happy it's compatible with TOF. Everything looks like TOF with a continuous murmur. Now we'll diagnose chondroitrichia with VST or VST chondroitrichia, most severe form of TOF. It's a large VST because of chondroitrichia. Unless the MAP casts are very large, we'll not get much pulmonary blood flow. Sinus will be deep, LV will be very small, inconspicuous, no Q waves in lateral leads. So that's another situation where ECG can be helpful to get the pulmonary blood flow. If you have very good pulmonary blood flow, you have well-developed LV forces, large R waves in V6 and Q waves in V6. So this guy had a poor pulmonary blood flow, but for that everything is ECG-wise compatible with TOF. And in the light of continuous murmur, your diagnosis will be chondroitrichia with VST. So P or PR is near normal, just like in any other TOF. RV dominance persists beyond infancy. And monophasic R in V1 that abruptly transmits to S wave in V2. That's a hallmark of all TOF lesions. And LV forces as well as Q waves in V6 depends on the pulmonary blood flow. It's QP. You can guess, reasonably guess QP based on the ECG. Skipping X-ray, going to next case. This again, 1 year and a month, cyanosis, but no spells. No heart failure, continuous murmur, and X-ray shows reduced pulmonary blood flow. Again, we are happy. It should be either pulmonary atresia with or without VST. Go to the ECG, check a clue. And most conspicuous thing you find is a huge pointed P wave, suggesting a right atrial enlargement. Loop is again clockwise, as you expect. And going to precordial leads, again, you have that transition. S wave has appeared in V2. V1 is showing a huge R wave. And V6 is showing reasonable R waves and some Q waves. That's why he didn't have any spell. It was not very poor pulmonary blood flow. It's just educate pulmonary blood flow. And you can diagnose in this ECG, pulmonary atresia, of course. But in contrast to previous ECG, the P wave is very much prominent. This should be the first clue that you are dealing with pulmonary atresia and intact IVS rather than a VST pulmonary atresia. VST pulmonary atresia, you will never have a huge pointed P wave, complex P wave. The exception may be adult TOF. In kids, you will never have that much pointed P wave in TOF as well as VST pulmonary atresia. When you have a pointed P wave, very huge P waves, you should think of a pulmonary atresia with intact IVS. And another interesting thing in pulmonary atresia with intact IVS, again, just as in any other condition, your pulmonary blood flow determines size of LV forces as well as Q waves. This is another example, sorry again for the poor quality, but you can make out that V1 is positive, S wave has happened in V2, and you have reasonable V6 R forces. But your RV size determines the precordial pattern in pulmonary atresia and intact IVS. I will give you more examples for that. Skip this X-ray. Just an example of pulmonary atresia with intact IVS who underwent BDGs, 26-year-old. But you can note conspicuously RV forces are absent. There's no R wave in V1, there's no S wave in V6. But for that, you have a continuous murmur, you have a cyanosis, you have a pointed P wave. And that's what pulmonary atresia with intact IVS is. Beyond early neonatal period, ECG reflects RV size. A small RV will result in adult type of RV will result in adult type of precordial progression, like we saw in the last ECG, V1 negative, V6 positive, whereas a large RV causes a QR in V1 and right atrial enlargement. At this point, again, as stressed during we discussed tricuspid atresia, loop will be clockwise and axis tend to be normal in pulmonary atresia with intact IVS. Whereas tricuspid atresia and along with pulmonary atresia, there is hypoplastic right heart. Whenever there is ectatic tricuspid wall, you expect a counterclockwise loop. So physiologically, both will be LV dominant, apex will be LV, cyanosis. One will have continuous murmur, other will not. Other may or may not have. But clockwise loop indicates a pulmonary atresia without a tricuspid atresia, whereas a counterclockwise loop suggests a hypoplastic right heart, tricuspid atresia along with pulmonary atresia. This is the same ECG which I showed along with trixpatricia, just to compare the loop clockwise in the pulmonary trachea and counterclockwise when you have a pulmonary trachea along with trixpatricia. Another fellow physiology, 9-year-old now, exertional fatigue, no spells, mild desaturation, to and fro murmur. Nothing else is needed for diagnosis here. The murmur is so classical that you need not resort to ECG or X-ray. Nonetheless, you should note that there are some changes in ECG when you have a pulmonary atresia, TOF with absent pulmonary wall. In contrast to other TOF variants, you will see entire precordial leads have predominant R waves. V1 is positive, so is V2, V3, till V6. Entire precordial leads have the same positive type of R waves and clockwise loop, of course. But you don't need ECG to diagnose pulmonary atresia with TOF with absent pulmonary wall. This is another example, same theme, to and fro murmur and cyanosis. And I'm just showing you the precordial leads. V1 to V6, everything positive. It's not much discussed finding, but still it's mentioned clearly in Perloff. And I have multiple examples to document this also. I'm just showing two of them. X-ray is also very much interesting. A huge dilated RPA, LPA, and MPA. In TOF with absent pulmonary wall, P waves are peaked and tall, and V1 to V6 show dominant R wave, in contrast to all other variants of TOF. So quick tips, you diagnose TOF like physiology when you have a cyanosis and spell, soft or absent P2. It again depends on integrated pulmonary blood flow is there or not. If it is totally absent, suspect other conditions like total pulmonary atresia. And pulmonary ejection systolic murmur is inversely proportional to severity of PS. The more severe the PS, softer the murmur, unlike in valvar PS. That's because of coexisting VST. Again, some differential diagnostic clues before you go into ECG. TOF will have soft P2. It's not absent P2, it is soft P2. And then ESM murmur, ejection systolic murmur in pulmonary atresia area. Whereas VST with pulmonary atresia, absent P2 and continuous murmur. So is pulmonary atresia with intact IVS. So in this scenario, ECG becomes very useful to differentiate between them. And again, DORV with BSC and PS can exactly mimic a TOF. And ECG can give some clues that it's not TOF, but DORV. Regarding LTGA, VST, PS, you diagnose it more by palpable L-post aorta rather than ECG. But still, ECG may sometimes show a counterclockwise loop and helpful in diagnosis. Whereas DTJ, VST, PS, among all these differential diagnoses, will have the most intense or severe form of the cyanosis and earliest presentation. ECG is not much useful to differentiate this. And single ventricle PS, sometimes L-post aorta may be palpable, but more often ECG also is not much useful. It can have any pattern. And TOF with absent pulmonary wall announces itself by its murmur. And TOF with AV canal defect, MR murmur may be audible in the apex pan-systolic murmur. And ECG may show the counterclockwise loop and help you in the differential diagnosis. So this is an important theme for you, especially for exams, TOF or TOF physiologies. And this is how you diagnose. I already mentioned and discussed each of these. So I think I'll skip this slide. This is an example of TOF with AV canal defect. Again, you can see that rapid transition is there. V1 to V2 waves as enlarged, and loop is counterclockwise. You can see the Q waves in AVL. And LV forces are not much. Like in AV canal defect, LV forces are not much because RV is the dominant component. Similar ECG you can expect in Austin Prime VST or an inlet VST, but all those situations, LV forces will also be there. Is classifiable into a miscellaneous. It can be a mimicker of anything. It's a 9-year-old lady, class 2 dyspnea, long standing, systolic murmur, upper sternal border, mild cardiomegaly, normal PPF. So we cannot classify it into any of these aforementioned physiologies. Whenever such a thing comes, always think of miscellaneous things like Epstein's, corrected TGA. Here's the ECG, which is very classical of corrected TGA. What you're seeing here is, again, if you go step by step, it is situs altus as per PO axis. Probably mesocardia because you have better ventricular forces in the mid pericardial leads. They regress as you go to the right or to the left. So it's a mesocardia, and common cardiac disease, so disease associated with mesocardia is corrected TGA. And then look for ventricular inversion. Look carefully, you can see small subtle Q waves here in V1, subtle Q waves, which are absent in V6, suggesting that it is a corrected TGA. It's a ventricular inversion. You can see deep Q waves in lead 3. It's not very deep. I can show you much deeper Q waves, but nonetheless, there is Q waves in lead 3, suggesting a right to left activation of septum. show you one or two more classical ECGs. That arrow represents the septal QOS in the right sided leads, V1, V3, or V4R, which are absent in left sided leads like V6. Absent QOS in lead. This combination should prompt you think of corrected TGA or any other conditions with inverted ventricles, including single ventricle. The 4 year, nearly 5 year cyanosis since mid infancy, mid cerebellar murmur, and no cardiomegaly. We'll look into ECG again. Similar ECG, but now with right axis. Absent QOS in V6. QOS are absent in V1 as well, but there is no QOS in V6 and dominance of right ventricle forces. Very important here to note that QOS need not be present in V1 to diagnose corrected TGA. Absence of QOS in V6 is more important than presence of QOS in V1. And more importantly, coexisting other cardiac lesions may distort these findings. In this case, it is still seen despite coexisting congenital heart disease. But sometimes pressure overload conditions may mask the findings. That guy had a VSTPS and top-like thing in corrected TGA, that's why RV was dominant, but nonetheless ECG showed enough clues to diagnose the corrected TGA. This is a 6-month baby with failure to thrive and pansystolic murmur. Failure to thrive in that age usually is heart failure, and heart failure with pansystolic murmur, again PST, AV canal defects, MR, mitral valve disease. Everything can be considered, but unless you consider corrected TGA, you will miss that. L post palpable aorta is the first clue for corrected TGA in clinical examination. And then comes the ECG, or X-ray shows the post-aorta shadow. And ECG shows this deep Q waves in lead 3 because of right to left activation of septum. And then again, absence of Q waves in lateral leads, with or without presence of Q waves in V1. More importantly, Q waves are absent in V6. And if you have mesocardia, that will also be reflected in the ECG like this. V1 as well as V6 shows inconspicuous forces, whereas mid-precordial leads show better R-wave or S-wave forces. The ECG in corrected TGA actually is a topic by in itself, electrophysiology of corrected TGA. But ECG reflects AV conduction issues, abnormal septal activation due to the ventricular inversion, and associated cardiac lesion. All the three factors play: AV conduction issues, abnormal septal activation, as well as associated cardiac lesion. So there's no single typical ECG that will give you a clue of corrected TGA, but commonest clue that you are going to get is deep S waves in lead 3 and lack of septal Q waves. Other things are manifested by affected lesions as well. This condition, because of the AV conduction issues, have a predilection to develop a first degree or more advanced AV block. That happens 1 to 2% per year during follow-up. And another subtle clue, I have not mentioned it, is positive T wave in all precordial leads. That's another marker of, that's especially important when you don't have a coexisting heart disease, because when you have a coexisting heart disease, it may be masked. Even here you can see it, I guess, positive from V1 to V6. That's because of side-by-side alignment of ventricles. There are no more anteroposterior or rightward and leftward. They're side-by-side. Sorry for the jumbling the slides. Discuss this. So X-ray in corrected TGA, maybe I will just discuss this corrected TGA X-ray because it's very important, otherwise we may miss it. The normal triad of contours of great vessels is altered in corrected TGA. Normal triad is ascending aorta forms the right heart border, arch comes to upper left heart border, followed by the main pulmonary artery segment. Instead, in corrected TGA, the vascular pedicle is narrow or very inconspicuous. Ascending aorta is no longer border forming in the right. Pulmonary artery is no longer border forming at all. An aortic shadow forms the left heart part. This is the aortic shadow here, L post aorta. If you keep your hand just lateral to the pulmonary artery area, you'll get the palpations of this aorta. That's the first clue of corrected TGA. Of course, other coexisting lesion can modify it. In mesocardia, as you see in this X-ray, base of X-axis is tilted towards midline. That's also very classical of corrected TGA. Okay, now this will be the last case. 13-year-old girl with hemoptysis, told to have a hole in the heart during infancy. History-wise, it's likely to be Eisenmenger because a hole in the heart and now hemoptysis means. So look for PH during clinical examination, but historically it may be Eisenmenger. Findings were surprising: long systolic left sternal border murmur in the pulmonary area, and desaturation, of course. I'm not going to discuss this ECG or case much, but I wanted to show this to show the very rare example of stereotypical precordial voltages. V1 to V6, every lead shows the same small R and big S pattern. There's no transition, that's because there's no septum. The single ventricle. Single ventricle can be a great muscle cutter. You can have a counterclockwise loop, you may not have it. You may have RV forces, LV forces, BV forces, or stereotypical QRS. BV forces are not very common, sorry. Other two can. This is the last slide. This is a very interesting quote by Arthur Conan Doyle. Both of them are applicable for ECG in congenital heart disease. The world is full of obvious things which nobody by any chance ever observes. And there is nothing more deceptive than the obvious fact. Both of them are equally applicable in congenital heart disease. Thank you, and now I will go to the question. The first question, can you explain clockwise and the counterclockwise loop mechanism? So in vector ECG, vector electrocardiogram, if you take frontal, sagittal and horizontal planes, your initial activation, if it happens from left to right means frontal plane left to right means left-sided leads, that is one end AVL, activation is going away from left to right. So you'll get a small Q wave in one end AVL. And subsequent ventricular mass is activated from above downwards and towards right. So that will give you a big R wave. And in clockwise loop, vice versa happens. Your initial activation is from right to left. That will give you a that will give you initial positive wave in one end AVL. So just look at inferior versus lateral leads. If you have a QR pattern in lateral leads, that is counterclockwise loop. If you have a QR pattern in inferior leads, that's a clockwise loop. I think you should not think much about loops here, because this concept is borrowed from vector cardiogram. Unless you read and understand vector cardiogram, it will be very difficult to understand loop scalar ECG. Again, I think that's the most confusing topic, counterclockwise versus clockwise. Reason or basis is just the direction of activation of the heart in the three dimensions. In vector cardiography, you have three sets of leads, Frank's system, that caters sagittal, coronal, as well as horizontal planes. Whereas in scalar ECG, you just have one or two. Two if you can stretch, frontal versus precordial. So we are trying to interpolate what is in the vector cardiogram to the scalar ECG. That's how the composite of clockwise and counterclockwise loop came in. But for all clinical purposes, the importance is just for identification of these, some congenital heart diseases. How to differentiate situs inverses with limb lead misplacement? So limb lead misplacement will have situs inverses type of finding only in precordial leads. Sorry, only in frontal leads. Whereas precordial leads will be totally normal. Whereas true dextrocardia, you will get situs inverses type of PVO axis in frontal leads and R wave regression in precordial leads. Yeah, this question is actually not answered yet. Why there is counterclockwise loop in DORV despite RV being dominant ventricle? So what Perloff says is,